Today, I will tell you something about overload, overload of inverters, overload of multis and quattros. What is an overload of an inverter? Well, basically, an overload of an inverter is that the current in an inverter is too high. And current of an inverter is too high, this could damage the inverter or it could damage the multi or quattro. So basically, that should be prevented. There are two situations of an overload. The first overload is that the current is just too high, but the inverter is still able to remain a certain voltage. So if you have a 230 volt inverter, you still have 230 volt on the output, but the current is just higher than what the unit is spec'd for. It can also happen that the load is so high that the inverter is also not able to remain the voltage onto its level. That means if you have a 230 volt inverter, that the inverter is not able to reach that 230 volts. That's also an overload, and that's even more critical one. So there is a distinction between those overload and how the inverter will react on that. If you look at the picture, you can see a row of black blocks. These small black boxes are in fact FETs. And these FETs are basically what is determining the maximum power of the inverter. The more FETs you have, or the more powerful FETs you have, the more energy an inverter can do. These FETs are being protected on current. So if the current is going too high, then it will tell the software, the firmware, to stop. You will find these FETs basically in all the models that we have. The smaller model inverters have fewer FETs or smaller FETs, and the larger inverters have more of these FETs. If something happens on overload, there are different situations that the unit will stop, or the unit will warn you, and the unit can also lock itself, but I can later on tell something more about that. If you have a system where you have more than one inverter, so you have a parallel system or you have a three-phase system, if one of the units is detecting an overload, it will stop the whole system. So if you have a three-phase system and one of the phases has an overload detected, then the complete system will stop. You will see that then also on the LEDs of the master. If you have a three-phase system, the master will blink and will tell you exactly which unit, what is going on in that system. So if you have an overload, or you have a low battery, or you have a temperature alarm, or something like that. So depending on where the fault is, the LEDs will flash. If you have the units connected to the VRM side, you're not always able to look at the LEDs. You can also look on the VRM side and see in a notification where the overload is. So it will tell you then exactly if it's on L1, L2 or L3. So then you have an idea on which phase of the system you have too much load connected, or maybe the start up of that load is too high. If an overload is detected by an inverter, it's not automatically switched it off immediately. It does that in a certain sequence. If an overload is detected, the first what you will see is a pre-alarm, an alarm that will flash the LED, and the LED will tell you there is something going on. This can also happen with temperature, also can happen with low battery, but you see a flashing LED, and that flashing LED tells you that is the probably cause of the switching off of the inverter later on. If that overload in this case continues, then that LED will lit up constantly, and that will also mean the unit will be switched off. But you will always have these three phases where it goes through. So first a blinking LED, then the alarm, and then combined with switching off of the inverter. So basically, if something happens, you will see first on the LED what's the cause and in which phase this overload is. This overload protection is controlled by the firmware, and that firmware is also deciding if the unit should be restarted or not. Basically, if a unit has a pre-alarm and then a complete alarm, so it will switch itself off, then it will try again to restart, and it will try again exactly after 30 seconds. These 30 seconds is a fixed value. That means if the unit is starting on another time frame than that 30 seconds, most likely something else is causing the switching off. This can be an assistant, this can be something you programmed, or it can also be something externally, that you cut the DC power or something. If the unit starts up in exactly 30 seconds, then you know, starting up and also the switching off is caused by the firmware. If it's something else, well, then you have to look for the cause of the overload or the switching off outside the unit, and it's something external. Also, if you switch off the unit on, you can also do that by the remote panel. So you can do that on the unit itself, but you can also have a remote panel connected to the inverter and switch the unit off and on with that. If the unit switches off and restarts again and switches off, it does that 3 times. If it started 3 times again and within 30 seconds the unit stopped, so that overload of your existing load is too high, then the unit goes into the lock state. That means the unit will not try to restart itself, it remains off. And it will show on the LED in what state it is. So it can be multiple causes that the unit switches off. It can be overload, it can also be overload and low battery. It could also be overload and temperature, for example. And these LEDs will constantly lit up on the unit. That means if you come to a system and you see these LEDs, you know what the reason is that unit will was switched off. The LEDs will never get better. It will only it can get worse. So you get always the maximum reason for the unit to be switched off. So if something happens during the switch off, you will remain seeing that on the LEDs. So this is what I said. You can restart the unit when it's locked by using the front switch on the inverter. You can also use the remote control, but you can also, when you're not on the site, you can also use the VRM portal to do that. I will show you later on how to do that exactly. If the unit starts up and within 30 seconds nothing happens, so it continues to run, but an overload occurs, well, after a minute or 2 minutes or more, then the timer is cleared. That means that the 3 times trying and then locking itself is always within 30 seconds. If you come through these 30 seconds, then basically the timer is reset and you have again 3 attempts that you could possibly try to start up the inverter. If you have the inverter which locked itself but it's on a remote location and you can connect to the unit with a remote console, then you can go to device list, you can select the multi or the quattro that you want to reset. Therefore you go to setup, and if you're in setup you will see 3 options: redetect system, system reset and alarms. And if you go for system reset, the unit, if it's locked, it will be switched off and on again. So then again you have your 3 attempts again. If it continues to do so, then something is really wrong and then you have to find another solution. But at least with VRM you can remotely reset the unit if possible. If you have a 3-phase system, of course you're resetting the master, and then the units should all restart again. Well, basically, what can an inverter handle? Well, the inverter can handle a maximum amount of current, and that maximum amount of current is determined in the design of that unit. If you, for instance, have a unit in this example, which is an 8000 VA, so a 48 volt 8000 VA, this is the current that it can do for about 30 minutes. So if you divide the 8000 VA by 230 volts, you will find that it's 35 amps. So the 35 amps is the maximum current what the inverter can handle for 30 minutes. That 30 minutes means under normal ambient temperature. If it's too warm, warmer than the specifications on the data sheet, you have less power. If it's colder, you at least even have more power that you can use from that inverter. In this, the measurement is in RMS. That means the power factor is irrelevant, because all the current is counted and measured. That means if you have a reactive power or you have a resistive power, it's the same measurement. The RMS value, so the true current, is used for determining how much the inverter can handle. Also, the RMS power is the power that the inverter actually does supply. Well, how can you determine that? Well, you can determine the current by using an RMS meter. So if you're using a power clamp like on the picture, make sure you have an RMS meter, because then you can see actually the same value of what the inverter is measuring. Going back to what the inverter can handle, basically you have 3 different overload situations to take into account. The first one is the maximum power, and the maximum power when the voltage is not at a level what it is supposed to be. So if you have a 230 volts inverter, but the inverter is not able to reach that 230 volts, it will try to supply that load with energy. This what you will see, for instance, when you start up an air conditioning of a large motor with a high startup power. If it sees that the maximum current is there, but the voltage is not at its level, it will try it for 30 cycles. 30 cycles means it's little more than half a second. So it will start up, no matter what the voltage is, and try with the maximum current what is available to start up that load. If the voltage reaches the set point, then it's okay. If it doesn't reach the set point within these 30 cycles, then the unit immediately switches off. The other maximum power is if the voltage is reached. So if you have a 230 volt inverter, you have 230 volt on the output and the current is maximum. The maximum power can then be about 2 minutes. This is the power what you can also see in the data sheet. If you have a 5K unit, 5000 watt unit, you will see sometimes the maximum power in the data sheet says 10 kilowatts. Then, well, that's for these 2 minutes what it is able to handle. Then the third one is a 30% overload. The 30% overload is basically the what I said in the example already. You divide the power by the voltage and then you have the 30 minutes load. This depends heavily on the ambient temperature. If the ambient temperature is higher than normal, what we expect, then you have less power. If the temperature is lower, then you even have some more time that you can use this overload power. So basically what it comes down to is if the voltage is to its set point or not, and what is the ambient temperature. If you're designing a system, always go for the safe margin. So use the 30% if needed, but never count on option 1 and 2, because these are only extreme situations. So try to avoid using these powers to specify a system. Well, if you take that into real life, what can you connect to an inverter? You have to take into account that some single phase engines, single phase electrical motors, can draw about 6 times the nominal power. That means if you have a 1000 watt inverter, you can only have a small single phase motor connected to that, because that single phase motor, in order to have it starting, it takes 6 times its nominal power. So that means you only have 10% of that inverter, more or less, what you can use to start up that engine. The other way around, if you have a 1000 watt electrical motor, you need about 6000 watt startup power to get this motor running. On three phase, that's slightly better. A three phase motor draws about 3 times its nominal power at startup. That means also in inverters, inverters handle three phase electrical motors better than single phase electrical motors. That's because basically the three phase motors already have a rotation in their phases, so that's easier for an electrical motor to start up. The other thing for inverters what you have to take into account is inductive load and capacitive load. An inductive load or a capacitive load is difficult for an inverter to handle, because an inverter is basically made to have a power factor 1. If you have an inductive load or a capacitive load, you have to take extra margin in your inverter. Your inverter, if you want to be on the safe side, needs about 100% reserve to be able to handle these capacitive or inductive loads. The 100% margin is for a power factor approximately 0.7, 0.8, something in that range. In that situations, the inverter is able to handle that load. So these three things, startup power, single phase, startup, three phase, is important, but also if it's a capacitive load or an inductive load. So basically, if you're designing a system, build in these margins to have the inverter be able to start up and handle these loads. What is also important in inverter systems, but also in other systems, of course, is the circuit breakers. Circuit breakers, they come in many forms. I will tell you a little bit about the differences in circuit breakers. Circuit breakers trip on two criteria. The one is the magnetic criteria, and the other one is the thermal one. The magnetic one is for fast response, and the thermal one is for overload on over time, so to say. If you look at this small graph, you can see three types of curves, the B, C, and D curve, and you can see that basically a B has a low magnetic threshold. That means for a normal household situation, that will handle startup power. The normal C is for more in-rush current. So that means it will allow you more magnetic threshold. So it will start up easier, high startup powers. The D is even higher. That can do 10 to 14 times the nominal power. That means in startup power, it's more forgiving than a curve B. So depending on which type of loads you have in your system, you choose also which type of circuit breakers you're going to use in this system. The other thing is, I think it's also often used, is the RCD breaker. The RCD breaker trips on magnetic threshold and also on the thermal threshold, but also have a fault current detection. That means if more energy is supplied to the system than comes back, because you have an electrical circuit, normally spoken, that the same amount of current is going to the circuit than you get in return of that circuit. If you lose current, so if you have a fault current, then this is detected by the RCD. If you have an RCD used in combination with a multi or with a quattro, we also advise to have the RCD on the output of the multi, so that it's also working in inverter mode, so that you have both the protection for pass-through and also in inverter mode. I think I'm already at my end of my presentation. Yeah. So I invite you to have, any questions, just do ask. Thomas Ho explain the 30% overload again, please. Well, basically, Thomas, a 30% overload, that is the power what the inverter can handle on current. But because of that power, the inverter will heat up. And that heat up eventually will make the inverter stop. We have the inverters named after what they can handle in 30 minutes. That means if you have a 5 kilowatt unit, you cannot 24/7 use that 5 kilowatt because the unit eventually will heat up. So if you have a 5 kilowatt unit, you can use that for 30 minutes under the normal ambient temperature. Matti would like to hear something more about motors and inverters. Basically what I explained is that electrical motors, you have two different options. You have single phase or you have three phase. What is important with a motor is that you can go through the startup phase. On a three phase, it's quite easy because a three phase system gives already a rotation magnetic field. And it means also the startup, therefore, will be lower. It's easier to start up a three-phase motor. That means if you have a three-phase engine, which is 1,000 watts, your inverter system only needs to handle about 3 kilowatts to be able to start up that motor. If you have that same motor, but then in a single-phase configuration, that means the inverter should be much more powerful because it needs to take more energy to the motor to get it running. And then it takes about 6 times the nominal power. And 6 times nominal power means that, in the example for a 1 kilowatt motor, you take a 3 kilowatt at least, because that is already on the edge, but a 3 kilowatt can supply 6 kilowatts of maximum power. So theoretically, that would be able to start up a 1,000 watt electrical motor. However, if you're going to count on the maximum power with that tight margin, it's perhaps better to select an inverter who has more capacity, more margin. So a 5 kilowatt or maybe even an 8 kilowatt unit should be more reliable in that perspective.
Johannes, I don't know if you can hear me.
Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah.
Oh, good. Is there any benefit between using different types of battery technology? Do you get a better performance on a lithium versus lead on an overload condition?
Yeah, the question is if the battery has influence on the overload. It is, because the voltage, an inverter makes an AC voltage out of DC. That means the better quality DC you have, the more easy it will be for the inverter. So certainly a lithium battery, which has a very firm DC voltage, will make performance on an inverter better than a lead battery, which is, dropping kind of easily in voltage when you have a big overload condition there. So yes, the size of the battery matters, Also the chemistry of the battery, so if you have lead or lithium, but also the wiring, of course. Also use the sufficient wiring that you prevent having a lot of losses in your system. I have a question on my list, and so do you think it's possible to use a 3000 multi-plus with a load that consumes 2500 peak for half a second every second all day long, and for the rest 2.5 seconds? It's a difficult one. Well, basically a 3000 watt VA multi plus can handle 2500 watt peak, but it depends then also of course on the temperature, because you're basically at the limit of what the unit can do. But theoretically you could do that, and for the rest 2.5 seconds of 100 watt, well, that's an easy one, that it will certainly do. But yeah, but again, if you're designing a system, please try to design that system a little with margin, to have some margin built in to have it reliable, because over time you can have that the batteries get a little bit worse, or you can have different ambient temperature situations, so then you could end up in a critical situation. But theoretically, Filippo, this should work. But do you want to know what the biggest multi-installation ever done by Victron is? Is that correct? Do I read that correctly? Yeah, well, from the top of my head, but I can be wrong, it's 270 kilowatts. That's the biggest one we ever did. But we're not advising people to go that large, because building these systems requires a lot of engineering, especially when you have a three-phase system. You make these systems with a lot of units. That means you have a lot of current distribution what you have to do, so therefore it's not supported to make systems that large. What we try to do is have the maximum of inverters to 6 units, and basically that comes down to about 100-150 kilowatts maximum. I also get Matthijs sends also a comment. There is a link on Victron Energy Live, there you can see a manual on parallel and three-phase systems. So there also a description is done on what the maximum size is and which things to consider that. Emmanuel asks, can you say a little bit more about inductive and capacitive loads with examples versus inverter power and capability? Well, basically, Emmanuel, if you have capacitive power, that means the unit needs to supply RMS power. So on energy that is more than basically what you should expect normally wise, and therefore the inverter will have a hard time. So if you have a lot of fluorescent lights, or you have other things which are inductive or capacitive, for an inverter you will have more power to supply than what meets the eye. So therefore you have to take that into account, that you need to have a bigger inverter than the lights that you connect. Like I said, if you have a power factor 0.7, around that, then you take at least 100% margin in your inverter, because your inverter needs to be able to power that extra load. Matti asks, to run a motor three-phase of 10 kilowatt, I need a 20 kilowatt inverter. Yeah, if you have a three-phase motor of 10 kilowatt, that means you have about, well, let's say 3 kilowatt per phase you need. You need to have a 20 kilowatt inverter system. Indeed, you have to have 3 times an 8 kilowatt to run that motor. Depends a little bit on what that motor is connected to. If you have something which is well, easily started up, you can do that. There are some specific loads that also are connected to something which is immediately taking a lot of energy. In that perspective, you can also do different things. For instance, a frequency controller. A frequency controller makes the motor start up slower than a direct drive. And therefore, a frequency controller can help improve the startup capacity of an inverter. You have also phase cutting devices, which lower the voltage, which normally for the grid is also meaning that you have less power from the grid to start up a motor. But if you use these kind of appliances for inverters, they actually work the other way around, because it's giving the inverter even a stretched startup period. So only frequency drives are good to know, good to work. Soft starts are actually not that well to be used with inverters. I got another question. The BMS low voltage will give a red bar on the VRM, but also a low voltage set on the dynamic cutoff setting. Both will appear red on the VRM. I would like to distinguish them. Well, basically, the dynamic cutoff is something within the inverter itself, and it's at the moment a part of ESS, so it's a software-driven alarm, and it has not so much to do with the actually overload of the inverter. It has more to do with what the battery is able to handle and what you want to have well, the battery be on discharge voltage, so to say. So it has not so much to do with the inverter itself on overload. If you want to, if you don't want to have dynamic cutoff, well, simply don't use ESS because ESS has that. Or you can also change the settings, of course, that you have a higher voltage level, and then you will basically also don't see that alarm anymore. Thank you for listening, and well, perhaps another time. Bye bye.